This is the Bears Barroom Radio Network. Parental discretion is advised.
There are so many streaming TV series.
So many channels.
I have a stream.
I just don't know which one to watch.
Is this show worth our time?
I have a stream.
I'm three seasons behind already. Is it even worth catching up?
I have a stream.
What's the series about? Well, my wife liked it too.
I have a stream.
What channel is it on? And who's in it?
I have a stream.
I want to watch something new, something original.
I have a stream.
I want to watch something that's action-packed.
I have a stream.
I have a story for you.
This story has got everything. Revenge.
Drugs. Greed.
Ronald McDonald.
Somebody went to the FBI and said, guess what's happening?
The McDonald's Monopoly game was fixed. The Bureau thought it was just some BS story.
Fast food fraud was not making any list of priorities.
Are you kidding me? This is what makes my fun meter go.
McDonald's Monopoly game gave millions of people a chance to win.
But from 1989 to 2001, there were almost no legitimate million-dollar winners.
The FBI told us the game pieces are being stolen.
McDonald's was shocked.
Conversations on the wiretap were coming in.
I'm hearing the name Uncle Jerry thrown around on the phone.
We started focusing more on trying to figure out who he was.
He's a freaking gangster.
Uncle Jerry was getting the tickets and selling them to other people.
This is a million-dollar winning ticket, and he's got it in a Ziploc sandwich bag that's not even Zip.
Somebody offers you $1 million, you're going to take it. Unless you got to kill somebody, then you might not, you know, you might not be interested.
Happening, barflies. It's the Bears Barroom Radio Network on Mixler.com. I have a stream podcast talking streaming TV series and all other events going on out there right now. With me, as always, is Joey Two Scoops. Joey, put away the hand sanitizer. What's happening?
Oh man, I can't get enough of this stuff, Tooch. I just want to drink it now.
Oh man, we got a great show tonight. Joe,
we do.
Two amazing guests, two amazing shows. I have a streaming TV news.
There's a lot of
first,
news.
Joe, oh man, the news is great.
But you and I are on a mission, Tooch.
We're on a mission. We're locked down and we got to help the people, Joe.
Would you say it's an impossible mission, Tooch?
Nothing's impossible, Joe. When we're talking streaming TV series, we're under lockdown. We're going to help everybody binge, put away the microwave burritos, and get Netflix going.
That's right. You may be in isolation, but there's a lot of shit you can watch on TV. Am I right?
That's right. What better way to pass the time than binging some TV shows recommended by I Have a Stream? And Joe, I'm getting thirsty. I have taken a Clorox sanitizing wipe and cleaned my bourbon glass.
Oh, thank goodness.
I'm ready to roll. We need to bring in our bartender.
Who's bartending tonight, Tooch? I don't know who I'm introducing.
Tormund Giants Bane.
Got it. Okay. I do have an intro for him, so here is our bartender.
But I'm also a bald ginger.
This man puts the me in metal. His beard is bigger than Danny DeVito. He's a nerd just like us, and he's here to talk about the shows you love. Put your hands together for the metal master, Aaron Michalski. Aaron, what's going on, buddy? How's the beard doing?
The beard is doing well, well-conditioned, well-shampooed. Actually, funny that you mentioned it. It's going much better than Tormund. Did you see that he actually has COVID-19?
I missed that.
Oh, yes, yeah. He does.
Yeah, it was
Christopher Hipju.
Yeah, he actually has COVID, so it's going better than him. I may not be quite as looking, but I don't have that, so we got that
get
going
well,
for me.
Get well, Tormund, from I Have a Stream. Get well.
Yes, sir, from Little Tormund over here.
All right, well. Joe and I would like to order some drinks, and
yes, sir.
It's the Roaring Twenties now. I usually have my bourbon, but I'm on an old fashioned kick.
Cool. Tormund. Yeah. We'll come up right that.
You're gonna do an old fashioned, Tooch? What's going on?
Yes, sir.
What's wrong with you?
Just for one show.
This home isolation thing's really getting to him, man.
I'm going stir crazy, Joe.
Oh, there it is. That sounds good, man.
Got it coming up. Joey, what are you drinking, sir?
All right. Well, it's a sign of the times. But you know I'm gonna have an ice cold Corona.
It's Corona time. Hey, it's Corona time right now.
That's right, it's Corona time.
Oh, okay. Too early.
Too soon. Well, either way, we got that stocked up here too, coming right up.
Oh man.
Ah, tastes like Mexico. Cerveza más fina.
Oh boy.
I do like Coronas though.
Mm-hmm.
I know.
Hot day.
All jokes aside, that company has nothing to do with the virus. Go get yourself a Corona.
Although I gotta tell you, I saw it was either the WHO or CDC sign. It was blue and yellow.
Was it
Corona?
Really?
I don't know if anybody see that on the news.
No.
Jesus.
All right. So, Joe, let's bring in our first guest. Oh wait, Tormund, you gotta order a drink first, though. Get yourself.
You know what? Let's do an old-fashioned. I'm going to get myself one of those.
Oh, right. Wow. It's
the Roaring 20s.
Change it up.
We got Prohibition, but it's okay. We're going to just drink ourselves to a happy splendor here on I Have a Stream.
Yes, sir.
But, Tooch, who am I introducing first? Which guest?
The barkeeper himself.
Of course. The guest of honor. And what better way to introduce him than Bears Barroom style?
He's a two-time Emmy Award-winning producer, the founder of the Bears Barroom Radio Network, the barkeeper himself, Aldo Gandia.
Of course, joining us is the barkeeper, the legend himself, Mr. Aldo Gandia. Aldo, how you doing, brother?
I am doing well, and I'm thrilled to be here. This is one of my favorite shows on the network because you guys are great, and the topic is one that I love. I love my
man.
I love my TV shows, and you guys keep me up to date. And, you know, I used to be a subscriber to Entertainment Weekly. I still am, but it comes out once a month now. So you guys filling that gap up with your weekly show, and thank you for that.
You know who does the Entertainment Weekly now and gets them early?
Oh, cool, dude. I didn't know that.
Most of exciting. I Have a Stream gets everything 1 month early, so you'll hear it here first.
And if you like Tooch enough, he'll find out your favorite movie and send you a magazine about it like he did with me for Star Wars.
Yes, sir. That's right.
Nice.
Very nice.
The Tooch is the man, of course. But Aldo, we're glad to have you here. Of course, we're going to be talking about McMillions on HBO. Yeah. And, of course...
Insider information.
That's right.
Real quick, Aldo, what are you drinking, sir? I'll get you a drink. You're paying for it, after all.
Absolutely. Well, get me a Corona also and two limes. And I just wanted to let people know, a Corona Premier, because it's 80 calories and about 2.5 carbs. And the word is that you should take it easy with alcohol consumption during this coronavirus, because it you know, alcohol, of course, affects your immune system. Sure. So let's take it easy tonight. We'll have one or two or three or four or five or six.
It's Corona time. Hey, it's Corona time right now.
There you go. Thank you.
Man, I tell you, in self-isolation, I'm going to have a hard time staying away from the bourbon, Aldo.
I hear you. I know that problem.
All right. And Joe, let's bring in our second guest, too. He wants to join in the party. Might as well hang out in the barroom with the gang.
The house is full. That's right. The house is full tonight, Tooch. And we got one more special guest and his very special return. And here is his intro.
Ladies and gentlemen, you know him as the platinum-piped voice of Bears Barroom. But little did you know, when it comes to lovemaking, this guy is known as the man who unites nations. This guy knows more about Chicago Bears football and television than Jason Lockenfora does about being wrong all the time. Everyone, get out of your seats, especially all the ladies, and give it up.
For me?
Seriously, for me! I'm Dan Aguire!
And don't forget to hit me up on Twitter, ladies.
Dan Aguire.
Dan Aguire. I'm shouting you out.
Oh, great guy. And I don't want
you, and I don't need you. Speaking of beautiful people, we have Dan Aguire joining us tonight. Dan, how you doing, brother?
I'm well. Back from the dead. Of course, I may just die from the virus now that I'm on the air, but like I said, somebody in my county's been diagnosed with this, so it's scary times. But
it's everywhere, dude.
I'm here to do what I do with the ladies in the bedroom, and that is overperform.
Oh, there you go. I like that.
I'm kidding. Dan is here to help us with Westworld Season 3, Episode 1. He's going to help us recap the beginning of the third season of Westworld.
Indeed. And I'm not drinking. I have to work 911 later tonight, so I'll just be drinking soda and be a pussy.
I could pour you a nice cold Pepsi here. How about that?
There you go.
There you go. Very frothy.
There you go.
All right. All right, so let's talk some McMillions now. Our guest, our first guest, was working for McDonald's when the whole scandal went down. Actually, I was working for one of the marketing companies, too, not Simon Marketing, but Frankel, who also did promotions for McDonald's. So when I was working at Frankel, you know, that story was floating around, too. Aldo, little backstory?
Yeah, well, the Monopoly game piece game started with McDonald's back in 1987. It was a... this is inside information. I actually have never shared this information before, but in the mid 1990s, we had a CEO change, and he told me that sales at McDonald's over a 10-year period had dropped off a dramatic amount. They were serving every day on average 55 million customers a day around the world, the CEO told me. And what happened over a 10-year period is they lost 10 million customers a day. And what was the saving grace for the company that kept it afloat for many franchisees was the Monopoly game, because every time they ran Monopoly, sales went through the roof. People weren't so much interested in consuming the food or going to a restaurant with the plastic seating or seeing a Ronald McDonald that was scaring the kids. They wanted the game pieces with a chance to win the money, the $1 million. Well, as this brilliant HBO show shows, there was a scam going on, and one of the marketing companies involved with it was behind it. I don't want to give too much away, because one of the great things about this show is that it reveals things like a whodunit, like a crime thriller. And so I don't think we should mention who the guy is behind it, who Uncle Jerry is, and so forth. I think that people should be surprised by what happens here, but it is a very well constructed, although at certain points I think the show carries a little bit too much fat. It could have maybe gone from a 6-part miniseries to a 4-part miniseries.
Yeah.
But nonetheless,
yeah, I agree.
Yeah. Nonetheless, there are some great characters, and one of the major characters on it is the McDonald's spokesman, Amy Murray. She is the senior marketing director. At the time, I did a number of projects with her, and so those images that you see of Amy in the 80s and 90s when she was assisting the FBI, that's the Amy I worked with back when I was there.
Wow, and she was cute. Awesome.
Yeah, she very, was cute. Very cute. Yes. And the day that the FBI announced this sting, I was called up at 4 a.m. in the morning by my boss. He goes, there's something going on over at the campus office building, which is where the CEO had his office.
Oak Brook, Illinois?
Yes, exactly. Okay. And not the Plaza building, which is shown on a lot of images in the McMillions, but it was all, actually the campus that McDonald's had a huge, like four buildings campus before moving to downtown Chicago about 3 years ago. But nonetheless, so I show up at with a camera crew at about 5 a.m., maybe it was 6 a.m., and we set up and we're ready, waiting for the CEO to come down. And we're waiting. And Amy was there, and she's telling us they're still working on, you know, the script and what to say. And do you know what it's about, Amy? No, I don't know anything. I don't know anything at all about it. Well, she did. and finally, the CEO at the time, John Greenberg, comes down, and he makes this announcement that Simon Marketing was behind this scam where they were stealing game pieces and basically picking winners. He announced that what he didn't talk about, and this is the other inside information that's not shared on the show, is that McDonald's did everything possible to disguise the part that the mob was a part of this whole operation, that basically the guy that was responsible for stealing these game pieces had enlisted a member of the mob to help with the whole operation. And McDonald's just didn't want to see headlines saying McDonald's and the mob. And eventually it did get out, but it was buried by 9/11. All the news media attention turned to that bigger event. And that really, really helped save McDonald's reputation, because there are a lot of McDonald's restaurants in small towns and conservative towns where people would have said, I'm not going to take my kids to a mob run restaurant. They would have gotten the whole
restaurant.
And so McDonald's just went to certain lengths to, you know, try to bury some of that mob story behind it. But the show is excellent. I'd love to hear Tooch. I know you've seen all six episodes now. I'd love to hear what you think about it.
I did. I remember it going on. Of course, like I said, I worked at a company where McDonald's was one of our clients, doing promotional materials as well. In fact, Bud Frankel was his account in McDonald's basically launched his company, and he had invented two of the things. One was the Happy Meal, the other was the Olympics game. Yeah. When the U.S. wins, you win, which is what I remember when I was a kid.
Yeah.
Every time, you know, the gold medal, you'd get a free, you know, item at McDonald's. And back at that time, McDonald's, I mean, there wasn't the amount of fast food places like there are today. I mean, there's 10 times the amount of fast food places. McDonald's, you know, while not the only game in town, they had a huge market share. Mm-hmm. Now, the thing that struck me the most, McMillions is a great drama. You know, it brings you along, you know, police procedural, a lot of legal procedures. But it also, like you said, revealed slowly. And there was the Simon Marketing, but there was also Dittler Brothers Printing.
Right.
And I felt bad, you know, because one guy ended up taking down two companies. A lot of people lost their jobs. Yes. And that's the one thing that stays with me the most about McMillions. But, man, I would really recommend this for people. It may not, you know, it may not be your normal cup of tea. You know, it doesn't have action or anything like that. But, you know, it's a piece of American history, you know, that we all went through, whether we remember it or not. But,
yeah,
you know,
I'm totally with you there. And, you know, there are a lot of interesting characters. The FBI, the main FBI guy, who basically said, Doug. I want this case. He's quite the character. And, yeah, when you get to that final episode where they show you the ramifications of basically what one man did, because he engineered this whole thing, this whole scam, and the impact that it had on the lives of people. You know, innocent people who knew nothing about it, the printing company that was printing these tickets, and how they lost their jobs. It is heartbreaking to see that. I mean, I was swearing at the screen and swearing at, you know, the lenient justice, in my opinion, the lenient crime, what's it called?
Syndicate? Offensive.
Yeah. It just wasn't, you know, this guy did some incredibly terrible things, and he's now home in a beautiful house.
He got like 6 years in one day, I think, or something like that.
Right, and a fine that he's paying off like $300 a month, and he's got hundreds of thousands, if not millions, stashed away somewhere.
Probably, yeah.
So it is infuriating and really emotional there at the end because of all the innocent people impacted. But I do highly recommend it. You know, and there are going to be some parts in it where you're going to go, oh, this part is a little slow. I really need to introduce this character. Well, stick with it because it all pays off nicely.
Yeah, the FBI agents were great, too. It all started with a Post-it note on an old computer. What the hell is this? McDonald's. The young agent, he wanted his first case. He was bored of doing all these, like, you know, paperwork. You know, they said the FBI agents hated doing this routine, which, you know, he was stuck on. He was 24 years old. He was new at the Bureau. And he took, you know, he was like, what is that Post-it note? Give me that. Let's look into this. Let me take this, you know. Mm-hmm. And he was really good, too. I think his name was Doug Graham.
Doug Matthews.
Agent Matthews. Yeah, he was excellent.
And this story is so fascinating that Ben Affleck and Matt Damon have licensed the material, and they've been working on a script now for over a year, about 2 years now. They turned it into a Hollywood film, and it was about a month ago when McMillions first started running and Affleck was at. So what's the status of the movie? He goes, we're still have the green light. We're almost done with the script. This is a very complicated script because it has so many layers. And I think that if this thing is done right, it could be a fascinating, fascinating motion picture and could stay pretty much close to the truth. You know, they will probably have to condense certain characters, you know, how they did. This character represents three figures in the story, but they could do a great job. And having a Matt Damon, Ben Affleck producing team. And I think Damon is going to play the role of that FBI agent or maybe of the Uncle Jerry character. That should be fascinating to watch.
And you find it on HBO?
Yeah.
HBO
Go, HBO Now, whatever your HBO streaming service, it's there.
Joe and Aaron, your initial thoughts?
Well, man,
Joe?
I tell you, I've only got to the first episode so far, Tooch, but I tell you what, it sucked me in, and I don't know what happened to that hour of my life, because that first episode just completely pulled me in. And I'm hook, line, and sinker. There couldn't be a better time to be quarantined, so I'm going to get through the other five episodes. I highly, highly recommend what I've seen so far. And it's I can imagine that movie that they're working on is going to be amazing. So I'm looking forward to that, too.
All right. And Aaron, initial thoughts for the audience?
No, I really enjoy it. I like the kind of... I like how it's true, but the thing I appreciate about it, it's got the characters from the story in it. Like, it's not just somebody recounting what actually happened with people. It's these people recounting what happened with them. Yeah. Like, that, to me, I mean, it gives it validity, but it also just makes it so much more exciting to see, you know, the emotion on their face, you know, just to see what they actually went through. And they're not just some person talking about what they studied or, you know, anything that they investigated themselves.
Yeah, it's the actual people about 20 years later, 18 years later after they were sentenced. And, you know, the complicated law, they end up getting them on mail fraud, you know.
Yeah,
but right. A lot of these people, you know, they argued a bunch of different things. But, I mean, yeah, I think if you're on the jury, like, man, come on. You took $1 million, guilty, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the episode where the defense attorney is explaining what defense route they took. You're just listening to some of the rationale they try to make in that. Yeah. not guilty because it is. He's like, it's like, get out of here.
Right.
That was one thing that stuck with me. I was like, come on. I think the jury returned, all the jury returned unanimous guilty because, I mean, it's just so obvious. You know, you cashed a prize, you know? That's right. You had to know what was going on.
Indeed.
Yeah. And of course, you know, they had tapes and everything of most of the people. One guy didn't even get to, he was the last winner. He didn't even get anything. He just got went to jail.
That's right. That's
yeah,
right.
He definitely didn't. He definitely didn't win.
Yeah, he didn't win nothing. But yeah,
he lost.
All right. Well, that's McMillions on HBO, and let's go around and see what everyone's watching. What can they recommend to the I Have a Stream audience? And we will start. Let's start with Dan Aguire. Danny, are you? What are you watching? Streaming anything you can recommend to the I Have a Stream audience?
If I could say to comment on what you all said about McMillions first, I didn't watch it, and the reason why initially I thought was like, going back, what is it, like 20 years ago?
Yeah,
yeah.
I remember it well, and I just thought this whole thing is a scam, is nefarious. Even when I was a kid, I thought, well, that's bullshit. No one's going to actually. So I guess I thought that it couldn't really be an interesting documentary, but I mean, I have to say, you all have kind of sold me on it. Maybe I'm going to go and find this.
Right.
But to ask your question, what am I watching? Well, obviously, Westworld just came back.
Oh, yeah.
Season 10 of Curb Your Enthusiasm ramps up this Sunday. I've caught into something late. Season 2 just started on Showtime. It's got Don Cheadle in it. It's about the market crash in the late 80s. And, of course, he's, like, on a bunch of coke and having copious amounts of sex. But it's called, I think, Black Monday, which is a reference to the stock failure. But that was pretty cool. And I want to watch a documentary that started this week on HBO. It's on my TiVo. The dude that was in The Night Of. What? Somebody help me out here. What's his name? Did you watch The Night Of?
The suspect or the cop?
The attorney, the guy that had he was always scratching and shit.
Oh, John Turturro.
Yeah. He's in something on HBO that came on a Monday, a three-parter.
Yeah, The Plot Against America. Yes.
Yeah. That looks really good.
Oh, okay. Sure.
Right. Yeah. It has Winona Ryder, too. I
love Winona Ryder. Heathers is one of my all-time favorite movies.
Isn't that an alternate reality kind of show?
Yeah, I saw episode one. I can tell you it's based on the Philip Roth book basically the premise is Charles Lindbergh was famous at the day because he made that transatlantic flight on the Spirit of St. Louis plane. Sure. He was a national hero and stuff. But he had pro Adolf Hitler feelings. And so he did. He was supposed to run for president. I think the campaign thing fell apart. But Roth, in his book, his take is that he does run and he does beat Franklin Delano Roosevelt, and the country then turns into a fascist regime. So episode one does run very slow, but it starts to pick up momentum towards the end. They're basically giving you information about the characters and the setting and so forth, but it's kind of guaranteed to take off. The people behind it are the people behind The Wire, the sensational HBO show from the 90s. So I actually, at one point during episode one, I was like, do I really want to watch this? But I said, you know what? I got to give David Simon a break here. This guy is sensational. And I'm glad that I did, because by the end of episode one, I was totally hooked.
Wow. Ooh. Okay. That's on HBO too as well, right?
Correct.
It airs on Mondays, because I haven't had a chance to watch it yet. It was on Monday though.
All right.
I think you're going to love it, Dan.
I'm certainly looking forward to it now. And I love Winona Ryder, for real. Beetlejuice, Heathers, you know.
Oh, fuck yeah, dude.
Stranger Things,
too. You can see her in Stranger Things.
Is she on Stranger Things?
Yeah.
She's the mom.
Great show, man. Yeah, if you want to relive the 80s, go through Stranger Things. But yeah,
about that, I was telling you, I had a hard time like being sold like the 13 and 14 year olds.
Totally,
it's so good. Yeah, season, I'm there with so you. Good.
Season two or three, Joe? That was season. They're on season four now or three? Stranger Things.
They are on season.
They're going to be making four.
Four. They'll be making season four. Okay. So we recapped season three with Ethan Coltramiro, I believe, right, Joe?
Yes.
All right. So, Aldo, anything you can recommend?
Yeah.
To the,
I, I recommend a show on Epics based on the H.G. Wells classic novel, War of the Worlds. It's been remade into a couple of movies, a movie in the, I think it was in the 60s that probably kids, you know, in the people who are in their 30s, 40s, 50s, and 60s now probably remember the movie with Rod Taylor, I believe, and then Tom Cruise made a movie not too long ago. Well, right now it is a television series, and I also understand it was a TV series made about a year or two ago, but this is a new series that just started on Epics, and for those of you who don't know the story, it's basically an invasion of aliens, extraterrestrials, and they are not friendly. They want to take over the world. And so the change with this particular show is that it feels a lot like The Walking Dead, because in episode one, when you get these aliens invading Earth, all of a sudden now you're only left with a handful of survivors, and the story follows their voyage to find help and to find the colony that they can live with and how to deal with these extraterrestrials and so forth. It has a very, very strong Walking Dead vibe to it. I've now seen four episodes, and I highly recommend it. A little slow at times, just like The Walking Dead could be at times when they were following characters through their individual stories. But if you stick with it, I think you'll like it.
All right, and that's on Epics, man. I'm going to have to order Epics now. But I love it. Right. Remember when I was a kid, the original one scared the shit out of me. Yeah. You know, it's like, I'm looking back on it now, I'd probably be like, that was not so scary then. Really? Of course, and then the Tom Cruise movie directed by Steven Spielberg, which was excellent, too.
Excellent movie.
That was also a little scary at times,
I've
too.
I've never watched The Walking Dead, not one episode.
What?
I don't know why. I just never did.
Shame.
Pretty early on, I lost interest in it. But it's. I mean, there's a lot of people that really enjoy it too, though. So it is.
I haven't watched season 10. I've watched season 9, 1 through 9. But wait for that to come out for free.
I'm going to jump in real quick and talk about something that we just started watching. Came out on Hulu. Actually, they dropped it early. The first episode, because of course, the coronavirus quarantine.
Oh, nice.
Little Fires Everywhere premiered on Hulu. Yeah. It's actually based off the novel. The movie or the series stars Reese Witherspoon and Kerry Washington. The first episode's out now. My wife and I watched it last night. It's fantastic. I don't really want to tell you too much of what it's about because it kind of gives it away. But it definitely, it basically starts with, you know, that the main character's house is on fire, and it does a flashback of basically trying to figure out, like, who set their house on fire, and it just kind of deep dives into, like, this little small town. It's a really, really cool show.
Nice, and that's on Hulu.
Yeah, it's on Hulu. Premiered, came out yesterday.
Excellent. All right, and Aaron, how about you? Anything you want to recommend to the audience?
Corona quarantine? Yeah, there's a bunch of stuff that's coming up. We're talking about diseases and we're talking about zombies. The show I've mentioned before, Kingdom, actually just came out with its second season on March 13th. And that's
I started the first two episodes. Yeah, it's very
super good. I finished that one. Another one I watched was, I've watched Kingdom. And then, another subtitle one, because I love the subtitle ones. Because if you don't watch subtitles, we've talked about this. Teach yourself. Right. If you don't watch subtitles, you're missing out on so much awesome art out there in the world of video. In fact, I mean, one of my favorite movie of all time, I recommended to you, and you said you loved it, the Along with the Gods, the Two Worlds.
Yes, I cried at the end.
It's such a good movie.
Great movie.
The second one came out, too. And
that's on Hulu, too. I haven't watched the second one. The first one is
The killer. First one is on Hulu, yeah. The second one's just as good because it keeps all the same people.
Tell the audience a little bit about Along with the Gods, because I think it's a really special movie. I think this audience would really love it.
Totally. So it's South Korean, if I'm not mistaken. And basically what happens is when you die, and I think it's in the Buddhist culture, there are, and I can't remember the number, there's like seven or nine trials that you got to go through. Basically kind of follows like this, I want to say, it's a little bit like the seven deadly sins. And you get these three guardians that essentially, and I don't know how much
help. They're your lawyers.
They're your lawyers.
Yeah.
But like they go on and they take this guy through. And there's like a tribunal, a jury that's trying to convict him to stop him from, if you make it through all the seven or nine trials, you get reincarnated. So the lawyers are trying to get him through and explain everything that he's done that was good. And these guys are trying to condemn him.
At a time.
but it's probably one of the most beautiful movies I've ever seen, just cinematography wise. Just to go through the different hells, and there's a frozen hell, and there's a water hell.
It's funny too. There's some funny parts, but it's sad. It's life affirming. You know, a little bit's revealed about him, his life in flashback.
Absolutely. No. Yeah. The first, I mean, it was one of those, I passed it a bunch of times and I was like, I don't know. And one day I was like, screw it, I'll give it a shot. And it was everything that I wanted it to be, or it blew me away. I didn't expect it to be as good as it was. So I get super excited when I see something that I love. And that's one that I tell everybody about. And I think you're the only one that's actually watched it.
Yeah. I admit I cried at the end of it. It was really good.
And the second one's just as good.
I got teary. So you'll
have to check the second one. There's the third one. I'm not sure when that one's coming out. Yeah,
that's on Hulu as well.
No, I'm not sure when the second one isn't on Hulu. I don't think.
Yeah, they're both on Hulu.
Oh, killer! Okay, I know
the second one is.
Okay, groovy. I don't know if I think
it's on there too.
So yeah, no, for sure. Yeah, it's an awesome movie. But the show is I finished Kingdom. Diablero is another one I think I've mentioned before. And then I just started Altered Carbon season 2.
Okay, so I watched season 1. That was really good. Love the book by Richard K. Morgan.
Yeah.
If you get a chance, Altered Carbon is out there, man. It's far out. And it's very violent, though. It's crazy.
So season 2's got Anthony Mackie in it.
It doesn't have Joel Kinnaman.
No. Did you finish season 1?
I finished season 1, yeah.
Well, because he basically, Kovacs gives the guy's sleeve back to the Latina lady.
Okay, so, the cop.
And he gets a new sleeve, and that's Anthony Mackie. So.
All right, excellent. All right, and then that movie, for everyone who's listening, was called Along with the Gods.
The Two Worlds.
Two Worlds, yep. And that you could find on Hulu. And Altered Carbon is on Netflix. And that's a crazy movie. A little bit of Westworld-ish with the body sleeves and everything like that.
Too. Yep. Yep, definitely.
Hey, can I add a movie title here? Stacey Hefner, who's a big friend of the barroom, have been talking on Twitter. She and I are both fans of a South Korean picture called Train to Busan.
That was great.
Oh, my gosh.
I think somebody recommended that to me.
That's on Netflix, too, I believe, right?
And it just came to mind because Aaron was talking about subtitles. Well, this movie is subtitled, but don't worry, because it's only about 10% subtitled. The rest is people screaming in agony as they're being attacked by zombies.
Okay, yeah.
All right, there you go.
Movie. Excellent.
If you recall the movie Snowpiercer, it's very similar to that.
Another killer movie.
Love Snowpiercer.
There's a bunch of people on a train, and there are the neighboring town has been afflicted with zombies, and so some of the people on the train have become zombies too. It is a great fun movie. Super. A lot of blood and guts and gore, just the way you like it.
Sign me up.
Especially in the age of coronavirus.
right
and you mentioned Snowpiercer too. That of course is a great movie too, with the caste system, the poor people who are starving on the back of the train, and the upper caste are at the front of the train. And this is a great segue into the movie I was going to recommend, which is on Netflix, and it was the People's Choice winner at the Toronto International Film Festival. It's called Platform. And Aaron, this is right. You got to watch this, man.
It's a
Spanish film, so you can watch it in subtitles, or it's dubbed with some crappy voices.
No, I love it.
It is about prisoners who are in some kind of hellish prison, and the ones at the top, at the top eat first. This big table set full of all sorts of great food goes down. The first prisoners eat food, and it goes down the next level. They get the scraps. By the time it gets down to the bottom, there ain't much left.
Yeah,
you gotta watch it. It's crazy. It's very violent. People are, of course, you know, resorting to savagery. There's all sorts of crazy stuff. What's going on is people, you know, die or change levels in this prison. It's crazy. It's called Platform. It's on Netflix. And, man, it is wacky. So if you get a chance to watch man, but don't watch it with the kids around, because it's not for kids.
No kids, not a problem.
Yeah, it's really cool, man. It's a little like Cube. It's a little bit like Snowpiercer. But it's called Platform.
And where can people find Netflix?
That was Netflix. Yep. I've scrolled past that, and I'm glad that you mentioned it because it kind of caught my eye. But now for sure, I'll give it a shot.
It is. It's crazy. You'll enjoy it, though.
Excellent.
It's dark humor and, you know, an examination of people who are it's perfect for this quarantine.
Yeah.
Okay. Sounds good.
It's Corona time.
You know what it's time for now? I think it's time for the news, Joe.
It's time for the news. Let's go ahead and do it.
What?
You look like Mary Poppins.
Is he cool?
Hell yeah, he's cool.
I'm Mary Poppins, y'all! Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?
It's entertainment news in two scoops or less.
Holy smokes!
That's right, it's time of the show where I give you the news in two scoops or less. And we have a lot of it this week, guys, so buckle up. Here we go. With coronavirus home quarantines and social distancing in full effect, many internet service providers have signed on to the FCC's Keep America Connected pledge and are waiving data limit restrictions for their customers while everyone is home and working from home. So go ahead and start streaming and binging all your favorite shows and movies, and make sure you follow I Have a Stream on Twitter for all the updates. Be sure to follow Bears Barroom as well for tons of great live shows and content. How's that for a first news story, Tooch?
Man, that was perfect. Sounds perfect.
All right, let's keep on crashing here. Here we go. All right, reminder, the new season of Ozark, Alert, is coming up on March 27th on Netflix. So it couldn't come at a better time for us, because I've been jonesing hardcore to get me some of that. So,
Marty Bird to the rescue, Joe.
Yeah, good old Marty Bird, money laundering. Let's all do a little bit of that, shall we? So, but now you can get Hulu, Disney Plus, and ESPN Plus for $12.99 a month. That's a pretty damn good deal for a coronavirus pandemic. That's a great deal, folks. So go and jump on that streaming bandwagon, because that's pretty dynamite.
All right.
Then Octavia Spencer and Tiffany Haddish, I always say it wrong, star as mother and daughter of a hair business dynasty in Netflix's new miniseries Self-Made, inspired by the life of Madame C.J. Walker. The four-part miniseries starts today. So you can go ahead and check that out on the Netflix. Go ahead and check it out. But another thing that's gotten delayed because of this coronavirus is the Friends reunion special for HBO, which has been delayed due to the coronavirus, of course. The special was supposed to mark the 25th anniversary of the hit TV show. Well, it looks like we have to wait a little bit longer for that. But what's an extra couple months when you've been waiting 15 years? So go ahead and get...
I'm brokenhearted.
Yeah, Aldo can't wait for that one.
I never watched one episode of Friends either.
Never. Dan and I are so much alike.
Do you have a drop for the next news bit?
Yeah, I do, actually. I have a drop for the next news bit. I just need to find it.
Well, Dan and I can wolf on Friends for a while.
Here, no, I got it. So here's the drop here for the next news bit.
But I was smoking fucking reefer.
Yes, that's right. A new show is hitting Netflix next month, and we have a feeling you'll want to add it to your queue. Cooked with Cannabis is a cooking competition series, and the contestants are challenged to make masterful dishes made with cannabis-infused ingredients. Aldo, are you on the first episode of that show?
Absolutely.
Sign him up. Keeping the news chugging along. We're only halfway through, folks. It just keeps on going.
Holy crap.
The Academy Award-winning film Parasite debuts April 8th on Hulu. It's exclusive to Hulu. Man. Make sure you check that out. And also...
And who's seen Parasite? Anybody here?
I have not.
I have not.
No?
Although
I have not either. I heard it's really good. Although you saw Parasite?
Love it. Absolutely.
That's
you're talking about the Academy Award winning movie, right?
That's right.
The best picture.
Highly, highly recommend it. Again, some people are going to be turned off by the subtitles, but don't worry about that. Even if you can catch 50% of what the titles are saying, don't worry about it. The movie is beautifully shot. You're going to intuitively know what is going on action-wise. It is such clever storytelling. Highly, highly recommend it. Highly recommend it.
It's great that they're giving that to us early during the quarantine. Mm-hmm. We give the Academy Award-winning motion picture on April 8th. I mean, we just had the Academy Awards.
Right.
Well, here's... Well,
the thing I was going to say about subtitles, too, is it's everybody gets turned off. They don't want to read. You can read way faster than you think you can. So you're not going to spend your whole time looking at the bottom of the screen. You read it and you flip up. And a lot of times, if they know it's going to be... If a lot of foreign people are going to be reading the subtitles, they pace it really well, too. Sure. So just try, I mean, give it a shot.
Yeah, and for those of you that are concerned about the subtitles, you may be impressed to know that HBO has actually picked up Parasite to be made into a limited series. So,
oh man,
that will be done in English. That will be done in English. So for those of you that don't want to get through it, I recommend you do anyway. But if you want to wait, it will be on HBO probably in the next year or two. So that's going to be exciting. So chugging along through the news. Actually, Aaron mentioned this when we started the show. Game of Thrones star and Aaron Michalski doppelganger, Christopher Hivju. Oh,
he said the magic word, Joe.
Doppelganger.
What's the magic word, Tooch?
Doppelganger.
Of course, I can't find it right now.
Doppelganger? Find it. We didn't think we'd come back to that one again, did we?
I didn't. I buried that one far away. But,
man, I'm sorry. Right.
But Christopher Hivju, who played Tormund Giantsbane on the hit series Game of Thrones, has tested positive for the coronavirus. We wish Tormund a speedy recovery along with Bearlissimo, who was not on Game of Thrones as far as we know, but he did get this news 6 hours before we did, so...
Oh, yep.
You know, gotta be... and conveniently enough, he was the one that did the doppelganger drop for us.
He did.
That's true, too.
And I'm trying to find it as we scroll through here, and it doesn't want to pop up, but that's okay. We'll go ahead and keep chugging through the news. I'm sure I'll find it later on. But renowned director David Lynch's The Straight Story debuts on Disney Plus Friday, April 3rd. Yes, absolutely. It's been out of print on DVD for years, but the 1999 film stars Richard Farnsworth as Alvin Strait, an Iowa farmer in poor health who rides a lawnmower from Iowa to Wisconsin to see his estranged and terminally ill brother one final time in order to mend their relationship.
Has any of you guys seen The Straight Story, Aldo?
Mm-mm.
I actually went to the premiere in Wisconsin.
What a great movie.
I'm good friends with the screenwriter, John Roach. And so if you guys want to invite him to be a guest on your show, I can definitely reach out to him. Let me tell you something. Man. This guy is a great storyteller. He's got David Lynch stories. He's got the making of the movie. He's got all sorts of Hollywood connections. He'd be a great guest. John Roach, the writer of Straight Story. Absolutely.
What a great movie. If you guys have not seen The Straight Story, Alvin Strait's sayings are so, you know, just colloquial Iowa. They're hilarious, man. It's a great movie. Touching. It was Richard Farnsworth, of course, nominated for an Academy Award for his acting performance in that. And Richard Farnsworth, of course, during the filming of that movie, Aldo was suffering from cancer. He had two bad hips. Right. You know, riding the lawnmower was everyday pain for him. And he committed suicide when the movie was completed in 2000. So.
Before you all move on, please. Because you mentioned David Lynch.
Yes.
I fortunately or unfortunately, depending on how you look at it, I have to go to both of my jobs still, which, again, I think is fortunate. But if I was sitting at the house, if you all haven't watched Twin Peaks, you should watch all three seasons. Fucking fantastic.
Yep. Right on. Did you see The Straight Story, Dan? He called it his most quirkiest movie ever, David Lynch.
I haven't seen it.
Well, okay, highly watch recommend it on Disney Plus soon.
Yep, Friday, April 3rd, coming to Disney Plus. And The magic word is doppelganger, Joe.
A doppelganger is a mysterious exact double of a living person. It is a German word that literally translates to double walker or double goer. A doppelganger isn't someone who just resembles you, but is in fact an exact double, right down to the way you walk, act, and dress.
Thank you, Berlissimo.
Thank you. Get well soon, sir.
Dan was my doppelganger. I guess I'm a little wrong there.
All right, and we got one last bit of news here, guys, before we get out of the news section. But lastly, huge news coming from Disney. After releasing Frozen 2 early on Disney Plus last week, Disney and Pixar are making an unprecedented new move by taking its newest film, Onward, which has only been in theaters for 2 weeks, and placing it for purchase on demand starting tonight. This move comes after the coronavirus has shut down all movie theaters, and then after a few weeks on demand, Onward will be added to Disney Plus on April 3rd for free viewing for anyone with a subscription. So what an unprecedented move for a brand new film. I mean, what do you guys think about that?
That's awesome.
Tooch?
I think with the movie theaters closing down, this I'm wondering if this might be more the norm with people, you know, releasing movies both at the theater and either short at the same time or shortly thereafter to on demand, so that people have the choice. They can continue to self-isolate or social distance, you know. I'm wondering if that will start to become a lot more common, Joe.
Well, they've been talking about it for years, and Universal also followed the kind of led the way. Their new Trolls movie, they did the same thing, and The Invisible Man. They made both of those available on demand for renting or purchasing as $20 for the newer films, which is exactly what it would cost you to go to the movies anyway.
Right.
Plus, you wouldn't have to pay for
Invisible
popcorn.
Invisible Man was awesome, by the way.
Yeah?
Yeah, I enjoyed the hell out of it. I really enjoyed it.
You saw Onward?
No. No, Invisible Man. I'm sure Onward's spectacular, but I'm talking about Invisible Man.
Yeah.
Invisible Man, I heard. Is that out at the theaters now?
Yes.
Yeah, came out a couple weeks ago. I like movies like that really paint a scene with very few characters. I love movies with a lot of big people, but I mean, this one doesn't have quite the big people, and it seems like there's only three or four main characters, and it really draws you in. It's a good movie.
Awesome.
Excellent. I thought it was okay. I saw it at the theater last Sunday. It was all right. I still don't know how to interpret the ending per se, but I don't want to spoil it.
Sure. No, we can talk about it later. No, absolutely.
Although, what do you think about movies becoming available more readily at home right after release?
Yeah, I have a little bit of a problem with it because, you know, I'm an old school. I love the movie theater experience. Yeah. You know, when I go to the movies, I spend time actually gauging the reaction of the audience. I love to see how the people are reacting to the movie going experience. Going to movies has been for all my life a social experience. And while now 99% of the time I'm watching movies at home, I still enjoy the social experience. And movie theater owners, you know, are going to get hit so poorly, so badly with this whole thing. It's a shame that it's happening. But then again, you know, I'm getting older and older, so watching first run movies at home, okay.
Times are changing.
You have to deal with the people.
But Tooch, what do you say we move on?
Yeah, we got Westworld season 3, episode 1. Joe, there should be a little snippet.
Yes, there is.
For the audience.
Here it is.
What do you want, Dolores?
Dominate this world. What is real?
That which is irreplaceable. We weren't here to code the hosts. We were here to decode the guests.
No world they create for us can compete with the real one.
So Dolores wants our world, Tooch, and what an epic version of Sweet Child of Mine. That's cool. That's the cool thing about this show is they transpose all these modern songs into like Western style.
I love it. I liked it so much I threw it in there, Joe, for you. That was all put together by me. Good stuff, man. The other stuff didn't normally come on that. That was just blank text or a blank spoken word. But yeah, initial impressions of season 301 will go around quickly before we get into the actual action. So we'll start with Danny. Your initial impressions, did you like where season 3 is going?
It was different. That's the best I can tell you. I don't know if I loved it. I did like that it eclipsed an hour and it wasn't rushed. It wasn't season 1 or 2, but maybe that's a good thing. I don't know how much time you want me to extrapolate off of this, but just vaguely, I would say, I think I'm not sure. My general reaction was, is this what we think is the futuristic world that we've been seeing? Is that another park, though?
Ah, great question.
Dude, we talked about this.
Yeah. Solipsism.
Yeah.
All brains and charms.
Nazi land.
Yeah.
We're going from one fake reality to another, which is one of the great things I love about Westworld. But unknown. But maybe they'll reveal that at the end of season 3, although this season's only 6 episodes, Dan, so they are a little bit longer, I'm told.
Do you remember we were actually texting? They said parks. At one
right,
point,
parks
as yes. in plural.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I definitely think there's more than one.
Right. And I don't know if you're watching.
Did you watch it after the credits?
I believe I did. I watched it immediately after. So I did not watch it before tonight.
Oh, man.
And I'm pretty sure I watched
another.
I did, Dan.
Okay. Okay. Do we want to disclose it to them?
Yeah. Go ahead, fellas.
Yeah. Rock and roll.
We didn't see, what's her name, Mav? Is that how you pronounce
Maeve.
It?
Maeve. Right, okay, so Maeve. You're talking about the
Thandie Newton's yeah. character.
Okay.
She was in a alternate reality, another park that seemed, again,
right.
to be very pro swastika, Nazi, Germany
right.
kind of place.
Okay,
right,
sure.
It's Italy of World War II.
Oh,
and
is that,
that's another park, and Maeve, we understand, did not escape with Dolores and her 5 eggs. She's in War World, which is another park of Delos, the Delos Resort.
Interesting.
Okay.
So she's still stuck in the park. The rest of the robots are off the reservation. But, the outside world where Dolores has escaped to is 2058 Earth, we think. Is 2058 Earth, but with Westworld, things aren't always what they seem. Now, this episode is called Parse Domine, which roughly translates to Lord Save Us. And this episode was directed by the creator, Jonathan Nolan, who's the brother of Christopher Nolan, who gave us Inception, the Batman movies, a lot of great stuff. And Dolores is leading her band of followers. I remember at the end of season 2, Dan, I don't know if you remember, but Bernard shot Dolores and took her mind egg out and placed it into the body of a new Charlotte Hale that he created that had an actual skeleton so it wouldn't explode when it left the park because the robots have detonators, have explosives in their neck that will detach their robot head from their body if they leave the boundaries
fun.
Of the park. So the new Charlotte, Dolores escaped in the new Charlotte body with 5 mind eggs. And last week, Dan, we were trying to theorize who were some of the people in her mind eggs. And one of them we believe is Bernard, who we saw at the end of season 2.
Mm-hmm.
And the other ones are a mystery, who the other 4 eggs are.
I figure Teddy's going to be one of them.
Teddy, yep. I would think, would be one of them, especially after this episode. And we'll talk about that in just a little bit.
Her dad, or the guy she perceived as her dad.
Peter Abernathy.
Sure.
Exactly.
And in the start of the show, we get a cold open with Dolores and a revenge kill of someone
who
abused her in the park, which was amazing. You get a look at the technology, and this guy had like a fortress that was computer controlled with everything. And Dolores infiltrates it by taking control of the computer of his house and makes it. The guy went to sleep, wakes up wearing a gas mask, and he's tied up. The rest of his household had been gone to sleep with the gas. He wakes up. And Dolores, of course, played by Evan Rachel Wood, the very beautiful Evan Rachel Wood.
Fantastic.
Dan, Evan Rachel Wood, hot or not?
I told you my guy Marilyn Manson was fucking her about 2006. Am I allowed to cuss on this show? I always forget that.
Yes.
Sure. Yeah. Okay, good. Fuck it. Let's do it.
Well, he was throwing a tour in 2007. So if Manson can do it, I can do it. Yes.
Right. Right. And did you guys notice when the guy that she killed, his name was Jerry, he put a disc into his mouth before he went to sleep?
Yeah.
What do you guys think that disc was that he was had to help him sleep? Or
giving him dreams would be my guess. Kind of augmented
so they
reality.
Were kind of hinting at it a little bit. So Aaron Paul's character throughout the episode is, and this isn't really a super spoiler, but he's talking to this voice in his head for like the whole episode. I think they're like memories, like of people that you don't want to let go.
Or some kind of therapy.
It's like a something
right. is how I understood.
Yeah.
He's conclusively right, because remember at the end of it, it's sort of revealed that the other guy he's been talking to is a dead soldier.
I picked up on that real early, actually, when they started talking.
When we get to Caleb's character, we introduce a new character who I got a few questions for you guys about Caleb, who's played by Aaron Paul, who played Jesse Pinkman on Breaking Bad.
Oh, yeah.
And I believe he was also in Big Love on HBO, too. I'm not sure. I wasn't a watcher of Big Love. But the world of 2058 Los Angeles. Man, I got to tell you, Joe, the set locations looked fantastic.
Yeah.
Man, it was like a lot of it was Singapore, you know, which, man, looks like a really
Tooch,
currently looks like a really.
Let me ask you this. I know you said it's Jonathan. City. I know you said it's Jonathan Nolan. Is it just me, or does some of the shots remind you of Dark Knight Christopher Nolan?
Oh yeah, absolutely. And the people who scouted these set locations, there was like some in Spain and other locations, I believe Taiwan. But to get it to look, you know,
yeah, it's cool.
Futuristic city where you kind of lose your orientation, but it looked great, man. Some of the shots they had of the future. Man, really looked cool. We catch up with Bernard in this one. He's hiding out. Now, I got to ask you, I think it was at the end of season two, Dolores said, "We're going to help each other," to Bernard. She's talking to Bernard at the end, but not as friends, as enemies. And you kind of see that in this episode where Charlotte tells the board of directors of Delos that the massacre at Westworld was engineered by Bernard.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think Bernard's in on this plan, you know, to make himself the scapegoat and help Charlotte and Dolores, or whoever Charlotte is, whoever's masquerading in Charlotte's body? What do you think, Aaron? Bernard on the plan?
It's one of those, I wonder too, if it's, you're gonna help me, but as an enemy. I wonder if he knows what he's doing, or if he's somehow an unwittingly kind of a part of a plan due to what somebody might have messed with, what it was that he knew, or like what he could do with his artificial intelligence.
Well, he's struggling. He's got two, it seems like he's got two
personas
inside of his body, and he's able to jack into his own system and control himself. I think as if he questions himself as if he were two different people.
Right. No, for sure.
But do you think Ford is behind that again?
What's that, Dan?
Do you think Ford is behind that again? Anthony Hopkins?
I think so, yeah. He's the one who split Bernard into two, I think, or put two into the same, you know, mind egg. You know, so... right. So Bernard is able to question himself and asks himself, "Would you lie to me, Bernard?"
That's one thing too. Now, I'm excited to see what the two voices are.
We know that Bernard was revealed to be a host. Dan, at the end of season two, the man in black, William, cut his arm open to check to see whether he was a host unknowingly, and they never showed what had happened to him. And of course, Ed Harris hasn't shown up in season three yet, but he is supposed to be on season three. Do you think that the man in black is a host or a human?
Well,
or
a clone? I think he is a host now, because again, post credits, the way season two ended, off the, again, Shane would always point out, you're saying off the top of your head all the time, but off the top of my head, I haven't watched it in 2 years or whatever it was, but early on in season two, you had Ed Harris working with the guy, the older guy, to try to make him seem like, what was his name? The guy that was trying to be immortal. I can't think of his name. He was playing Rolling Stones in the White
Room. James Delos, played by Peter Mullen. Okay.
There you go. So it went full circle at the end of season two. It showed Ed Harris as a host in the room, but you don't know what year that was. It doesn't mean that the man in black was dead yet per se, but that could have been a shot nonlinear, like in the future, like in 2058 LA or whatever.
I think so as well.
Yeah. The way season two ended though, it did show that he himself was trying to assimilate as a host the way he had been doing the whole season earlier for Delos. So again, it comes full circle with the irony there. I thought, I think it's obvious that he's a host, but right. I don't know. Or real guy still around too.
He could be a clone as well.
Yeah, could be.
Because Delos was James Delos, the owner, played by Peter Mullen, who's also an Ozark. He was, resurrected in new bodies. Everything, his consciousness placed into all these clone bodies that they incinerated in season two. When he would break down, the clone would eventually break down.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think maybe the man in black is. Maybe a little more stable version of what Delos was. The man in black. But when we get to Charlotte, or whoever's in Charlotte's body, she's the new CEO of Delos. And she is in charge of plotting. Now, there's another company, too, called Insight, which we also see Dolores trying to infiltrate Insight with Liam Dempsey, played by John Gallagher. And we'll get into that a little bit more. But the system invented by Insight is called Rehoboam, and that is a system AI mind that it seems like it's controlling this artificial intelligence. It's like a giant mind egg that looks like the ones that Dolores stole, just super huge. This artificial intelligence runs most of the world's functions, probably controlling a lot of infrastructure around in the future. So that's going to play, I think, a huge part. So Charlotte is working as the head of Delos, or whoever's inside Charlotte's body, and working with Dolores. And Dolores is trying to infiltrate Insight. I know it's a lot to follow along. But along the way, we meet Caleb, who's played by Aaron Paul, who's a war veteran, a regular guy, working stiff with PTSD, and he has that therapy hologram of, I guess it's his ex-soldier buddy, who's... Mm-hmm. Who calls him every day to, give him pep talks. It's like part of his PTSD therapy, I think. I kind of knew something was up, but the soldier was played by Kid Cudi, the music rap star.
Was it really?
If you didn't see that. Yes, wow. That was Kid Cudi. Played Francis, maybe the memory or holographic version of Caleb's friend, who we assume died in the war. Now, Caleb has a mom who's in the hospital. Now, when he goes to visit his mom in the hospital, he's obviously been struggling to pay her medical bills. She says, "You're not my son." Now, I got a question for you guys. Do you think Caleb is a host and doesn't know it? What do you think, Joe?
When she said that line, that kind of crossed my mind a little bit. No, you're definitely not my son. And the fact that he's got all these memories in his head and, he's talking to someone that's no longer around. That could be another thing. He could be a host that, doesn't know it, and he has this whole backstory that is eventually going to unravel, kind of similar to how Dolores's did.
Yeah, this is kind of why I'm excited about the show. Aaron, what do you think? Caleb, a regular guy, or a android that doesn't know he's an android?
I didn't even think about that angle. I kind of thought...
Did you catch the line from his mom?
No, I did, but said, I was
you're
wondering...
You're not my son.
No, I know, but I was wondering if maybe she has Alzheimer's.
Sure.
Kind of how it took.
That's what
if
we're supposed to
check it up on his mom.
That's what we're supposed to think. Yep.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah. Dan, what do you think? Caleb, human or host?
I agree with Aaron. At that point, I heard the line. I thought it was supposed to convey that she has dementia, and that it was supposed to show you that he feels extra incentive to try to get a job because he needs to pay for her health care.
Yeah, that's exactly right. He's struggling to pay for it. He uses this app called Rico, which I thought was great. It's like Tinder for crimes. It's like Grand Theft Auto, Joe. You can sign up to do it.
That's exactly what I thought. I'm like, man, it's like your phone on Grand Theft Auto.
It was great, man. Rico, of course, for racketeering, influencing corrupt organizations.
And Tooch, and of course, we get a cameo from former NFL player Marshawn Lynch.
And a crime buddy played by Marshawn Lynch, former Seahawks running back.
Who was high out of his mind.
Right, and he's kind of plays one of Caleb's associates. You know, him and I forget the lady's name who
she's good.
Was also
yeah,
there.
She's good too. I've seen her in a lot of stuff. I can't think of her name.
I can't either. But Caleb is making extra money performing petty crimes. Like, you know, it looked like he delivered a few packages. He doesn't do any, you know, what he calls personals, which I assume is assassinations.
Yeah,
could be.
I'm not sure. But that's how and by day he works with his coworker who's a robot, and they work running, you know, a computer line, you know, Ethernet cables
fiber.
Along big fiber optic cables along the side of buildings way up high, and he's trying to get into a higher paying job, and I love that scene where he was gets a call about how he didn't get the job, you know, and he was like trying to, well, what can I do? And then he's like, are you even a real person? You know, so the poor guy, you know, it's like how automation and AI has changed the lives of people in 2058. You know, you kind of feel sorry for him. But eventually he runs into Dolores, and now Dolores, trying to infiltrate Insight, ends up running into Connells, played by Tommy Flanagan. I don't know if you know who Tommy Flanagan is. He played He played Cicero in Gladiator.
Like, got a heck of an accent.
Russell Crowe's.
Oh, he was in Sons of Anarchy too.
He's got a scar on his face. He was in Sin City too. If you ever saw Sin City, he was the IRA bomber that Clive Owen's character runs afoul of in Sin City. But he plays kind of the bodyguard or fixer for John Gallagher's Liam Dempsey, the head of Insight. Now, we get into – this is where Dan's point about Teddy coming I wanted to get to. And Dolores ends up pretending to be unconscious while they're going to dump her body. And she ends up escaping from that and then replacing Connell's with a host and putting one of her mind eggs in the body of the Insight enforcer. Who do you think is inside of Connell's body, Dan? The new Connells.
It could be Teddy, but could I go back? I've been dying to say something just a minute ago. You've mentioned John Gallagher Jr. twice. I wanted to plug that he was in The Newsroom, which was a great show on HBO back in like 2012, 13, 14, that era.
Right.
Jeff Daniels was the lead. I thought that was a great show. The cool thing about Dolores, as I wanted to mention where Caleb finds her at the end, is I think we all know, so we're not spoiling. The cool thing about Dolores or Evan Rachel Wood in this episode, because going back to season two, she was like in Twitter threads, like mad at people for assuming that she was the villain and was accusing people of being sexist. It was almost like people like the way Hillary Clinton would just paint you as a sexist if you didn't like her. So it seemed like early in the episode she was somewhat the villain, and I almost want to dislike her. But during the time that they capture her or she acquiesces, whatever actually happened in that sequence, I found myself rooting for her too. That dichotomy of being the villain but then all of a sudden being the protagonist within 2 minutes is a good testament to her acting ability and how impressive I am in this show. But to answer your question, if I had to guess, the obvious one would be Teddy, but perhaps it would be somebody that, you know, I think the show kind of likes to go right and then hit you with the left. So maybe it's somebody completely that we're not foreseeing.
Let me throw one at you. It could be Stubbs. I don't know if you know who Stubbs was. He was the one who was played by one of the Hemsworths, Luke Hemsworth, the park
I guess he's like the park ranger.
He was the park ranger, yeah.
The park ranger. And at the end, when he lets Charlotte pass, stealing the mind eggs, you know, I forget what he says to her, but he kind of gives away that it was my programming, my central programming. I'm here to, you know, to take care of the park. You know, he was kind of a bodyguard as well.
Sure.
You know, it could be Stubbs inside the body of Collins. It's great that we have some new cast members like Aaron Paul and Tommy Flanagan and John Gallagher Jr. And now Vincent Castle, who's going to be in the Maeve storyline. And Maeve, of course, we see at the very end, like you said, Dan, she's trapped in War World in World War II Italy. So I'm excited about where Westworld Season 3 is going. I love this vision of the future, the dangerous flirtation with automation and artificial intelligence. You know, the vision of the future is very, very believable to me. Joe, what do you think of Westworld's vision of 2058?
I really enjoyed it, man. I'm looking forward to see where they're going to go. But my main thing here is, you know, I'm just impressed with where they're taking the story from where it was. You know, it took leaps and bounds, jumping to a whole new setting, so I'm excited for that. The only thing that I was a little caught off guard by was it was a little slow getting started, at least for me. But once it got towards the end, I was hook, line, and sinker.
Yeah, I really enjoyed Season 3, Episode 1 so far. Looking forward to Episode 2. And Danny, final thoughts on Westworld Season 301?
I wanted to go to somewhat of some normalcy. I kind of wanted to go back to a little bit the way it feels like something similar. I don't want the whole season to be the way the first episode was. Again, right. If it culminates in going back to the park, I want it to feel a little bit more like season one or two. So, you know, placate me a little bit here is the way I'm thinking. But you said there's only six episodes. I thought there were eight. But the six, that's even more disconcerting. So I hope that they don't waste a lot of time on that myself. But I didn't dislike it. I liked it. But if the whole season had that feel, I don't know if I would have ever liked the show.
Mm-hmm. You know? Yeah, you want to go back to the parks and get some robot poontang.
Well, like season two again had a Twin Peaks feel to me. That's right.
Oh, it was great.
Especially with Bernard not knowing if it's the present or the past.
Yes.
That is very David Lynch-ish. Mm-hmm. So I liked season two way better. But like I said, I don't know if this were the new season, like right now, this was the first season, like season one of Westworld, this new show, and that was the opening episode, I would be like, I don't know if I'm going to like this or not.
Oh,
based
wow, okay.
on the other two seasons, I feel like I'm going to really like it.
Non-linear storytelling where, you know, of course, the unreliability of memory, which I loved about season two, that they got a lot of complaints about the Jonathan Nolan and Lisa Joy about the complaints. To be honest, man, season two was so hard to follow. For me, it wasn't that hard to follow. I loved the mystery. And Dan, it doesn't seem like it was too hard for you to follow either. But
for the
people who Lisa Joy and Jonathan Nolan on Reddit all the time regarding Westworld, and they took what the fans had to say to heart, and they wanted to make season three a little bit more linear, yeah. and a little bit more easier to follow. And in fact, I mean, you could. My wife started watching season three with only limited background with season one and two, since season three is kind of doesn't have most of the parks or anything like that. I wouldn't recommend doing that.
No, I was because you get that's more what I was gonna say too. Yeah, I recommend watching season one and season two. For me, TV doesn't get a whole lot better than season one of Westworld. It's one of the best seasons of television I've ever seen. But what I was gonna say is, this episode had a lot of ground to cover, right? Because there's no parks.
It did.
It had to introduce a whole new time frame. So with that said, I think it was an admirable first episode because it covered a lot of ground. Mm-hmm. And it kind of set the story for where we're going to go. So I think the next, you know, five episodes are going to be really good.
Absolutely. Aldo, did we kindle your interest in Westworld? Are you going to come back to the show?
Absolutely. I just, it, you know, as happens to all of us, the season two got away from me. So I'm going to binge watch season two and hop on the train for season three. Season one was one of the best TV shows of the decade.
And I agree.
So I can't wait to catch up on the series.
You know, ironically, the people that I've tried to get into the show that didn't like it thought that season one was too much of a Western, because that's not really my genre either. But I think if you can get past that and then get into season two, again, I'm obviously partial to my own beliefs, but I think season two supersedes season one like 10 to 1. I thought, now don't get me wrong, one was great, but I thought season two really upped the ante. But it was too much of a Western. And again, a lot of people have conveyed that thought to me that I tried to impress them upon the show, like, hey, you really need to check this out. But they're like, I don't want to get a fucking Western, you know. But I think season two was better, though. That's just my opinion.
To me, it's the deepest. I said this last week. It's the deepest show in television history, as it deals with, you know, the nature of consciousness, artificial intelligence, free will, the future, what the future is going to look like. Really intense topics, metaphysical topics,
and intense nudity, Tooch.
Which is great too, but it uses the Western as a vehicle, the barbarism of it,
exactly.
The escapism of the Western, and that's well. Of course, you had Shogun World as well, in the end of season one, and Shogun World, of course, a lot like the Westerns. You know, I mean, I forget the Magnificent Seven was based on a Japanese Shogun movie, so a lot of similarities with that, and. We've reached the end of the show. I'd like to thank our guests, Joe, Aldo Gandia, the barkeeper, and Dan Aguire, and our bartender, Aaron Michalski, tonight, Joe. And where can we find Aldo on Twitter?
Well, go to @BearsBarroom.
Yes,
that's
sir.
Of what we do. And if you want to talk liberal politics, then you follow me at Aldo Barkeeper. You probably should stay away, because these are not good times to talk politics. But Bears Barroom on Twitter, and we've got a Facebook page too, Bears Barroom Radio Network.
Right on. Real quick, Aldo, your thoughts about the Bears free agent signings?
Well,
thumbs up, thumbs down.
Thumbs probably sideways, right? Because you're happy you got Robert Quinn. I believe it's necessary to build on your strengths, and I think they did that. They've got a pass rush now, which should help the defensive backs create more turnovers, although they still need to get a cornerback and a safety, in my opinion. And, you know, not too happy, of course, with the Nick Foles signing and Jimmy Graham signing. But I think that the improvements on the offense are going to be more on the coaching side than they're going to be in the personnel side. So we'll see.
They brought in a lot of extra coaching, a lot of extra veterans.
Yep.
And what do you think, Dan? Free agent signings.
I'm worried about Deion Bush being the other starter at safety. I don't know if that's the plan, but he signed a one-year deal today, and I have to think that they have to. I know Phil's like, fuck the cap, but at some point you have to adhere to the fucking cap. So yeah. They can't pay every. Plus, they need to worry about their offensive line still. They need another corner. So I bet you Bush is the starting safety. That concerns me. Jimmy Graham seems like he's been in the league since Wani was coaching. So I know that's not true, but does he have anything left? I mean,
he's got a knee.
Well, then look at the deal that Eric Ebron got today. I mean,
and it was for less money
than Graham. I don't get it.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Yeah, but I guess Ryan Pace is just like, oh well, I knew him in New Orleans, so. That supersedes everything.
Yeah, so these are win-now moves. They still think that window is wide open with the defense. And they brought in veteran leadership, especially at the quarterback position, in case their highly prized quarterback, high draft pick quarterback, doesn't pan out. Quarterbacks in the fourth year are when they start to take off, really. Yeah, what's up, Danny?
All right, one comment. Again, I was listening to Barilissimo today. Shout out to him and his family, and I hope that he's well. And continues to get well.
Absolutely.
So now them are shaving and doing manscaping and things you all don't care about.
Let's do it together.
I was listening to that. And basically, and again, I'm not disagreeing with George at all, but I guess I'm more of a like, okay, let me see it. I feel like the Bears defense, granted in 18, had all those turnovers, but even the Urlacher defense, I kind of feel like is always gets too much love because Chicago loves defense.
Yeah.
Like I heard them saying, going through the litany of players, well, who are you going to block here? And who are you going to block here? And who are you going to block here? Every time the Bears get a moderately good defense, I hear the same argument that they're going to be unstoppable. You won't be able to stop the interceptions and the sacks. And what about Eddie Goldman? And like, okay, let me see it. Because it feels like the defense, albeit good, again, we talk about the Nick Foles playoff game 2 years ago. It comes down to Cody Parkey. But they were giving up scores in the fourth quarter when we needed them to get a fucking stop. Mm. And how would Mitch Trubisky look right now? Let's just say he wins that game. They win, and then maybe he goes and beats the Rams because they didn't seem that overwhelmingly affordable, like or insurmountable. And then maybe he makes it to the NFC Championship game. Maybe we're reevaluating the young quarterback that we have now. So I guess not to go on a rant, I feel like I don't really necessarily want to give up on a 25-year-old, soon-to-be 26-year-old quarterback that you drafted in the second pick overall. But I understand what they're trying to do with Foles, too. I don't know. I think the defense gets too much love and the offense needs to get, you know, has to start scoring points.
No doubt about it, man. We
Joe, your thoughts?
I've been overwhelmingly disappointed aside from the Quinn signing. You know, I was really hoping they'd go the Ebron route. I thought Jimmy Graham just made them old and slow. I didn't know that Shane said it on Twitter earlier this week. I didn't think this team could get any slower, but somehow they did. I've been overwhelmingly disappointed. I still think, you know, this team needs a lot of help. Like Dan said, O-line, we need, you know, O-line especially is something we got to focus on. And I'm just concerned. I'm not sure Ryan Pace has any idea what he's doing right now, because it just feels like he's just kind of throwing darts at a blindfolded, and he's kind of hitting all different kind of marks. So
Ryan Pace walking down the halls of Hallis Hall. And heard George and his mom talking. Brian better get something going.
That's right.
So he made a few moves. But as far as safeties, Von Bell is still out there with the Saints signing Malcolm Jenkins.
Cordero Patterson.
Robbie Anderson.
Cordero Patterson trying to bring in Bell. Court him on Twitter. There's been a lot of that going on today. So that'd be nice.
Yeah. Robbie Anderson across from Allen Robinson would look nice. He's still out there. There's still some offensive linemen. Plenty of moves to be made.
I'm so glad Emmanuel Sanders didn't sign with Green Bay, by the way. If you saw that, I don't know if you saw during the show, he signed with the Saints.
Okay. That would be a nice
great
fit.
Signing
yeah.
for them opposite Michael Thomas. Yeah, they needed somebody opposite Michael Thomas. But, yeah, Dan, tell the audience where they can find you on Twitter.
Bears fan Dan.
All right, at Bears fan. Dan, Joe?
Well, mine's really hard to remember, but it's at Joe Mandel, so... That's where you could find me and all my shenanigans.
Right. And Barflies, please follow. I have a stream pod on Twitter and at Santucci_John and Joe. Thanks again for being the pilot of this show and take us out with a little Billy Joel again, maybe?
Yeah. I will. And before we get out of here real quick, I just wanted to thank Aaron Michalski as well. He had to take off a little early. Mm-hmm. He was feeling under the weather, but... you can follow Aaron at amichalski88 on Twitter.
Absolutely.
So huge thanks to him for joining us all the time.
Faithful bartender.
He is our faithful bartender. He always makes us nice and thirsty. So with that said, we'll catch you guys all next week. Thanks to all our guests. And adios until next time. Enjoy quarantine.
Stay safe and healthy.
Yes, stay safe and healthy. And we'll take it out with a little bit of Billy Joel.
I gotta tell you something, Dan. The Bears defense in that playoff game, the Eagles had 10 possessions. They gave up a total of 16 points. They gave touchdowns.
When you needed to stop, though. When you needed to stop.
Yeah, but you could blame the offense, too, for not sustaining drives. Foles threw two interceptions in the first half, and how many points did we see out of that? We saw two field goals. So you know, I you know, it's a team loss. I don't think you can blame it on the defense. And I thought they played well. Surely you want to see a stop there on that final drive, but it didn't happen. But it's, you can't blame them entirely. Let's face it. Mitch Trubisky didn't have a great game until he completed a couple of passes in the second half. So we're back to that whole thing. You gotta help a defense out with an offense. I mean, I'm looking at.
I can't disagree with you. I just think that it's, when your defense is supposed to be all world, then like when you need them to make the play, please make the fucking play.
Yeah.
But you're everything you're saying is accurate. I mean, you're right. Like, you got to score more than 15 points. But I just, like, on that show, I was like, well, how are you going to block Roy Robb? How are you going to block Mac? How are you going to block this? Every time I get sucked into thinking our defense is going to be, you know, the 85, which is the inevitable comparison, they always break my heart.
Absolutely. That's true. That is true.
Robert Quinn is going to, you know, he's going to really open some things up in that pass rush. I'll tell you, you can't block the ball.
He was really solid with the Rams. I didn't follow him too much in Dallas. But, yeah, I thought he was really good with the Rams. So I am excited about that. But it just, every time you get your hopes up, it's like, oh, that's like when someone hurts their knee or like something happens. It always, like, it's just like Julius Peppers is the epitome of that. You think, oh, we've got our man, and he never does anything. But he played better older with the Packers than he did with the Bears, in my opinion.
He is a talented pass rusher, though, Robert Quinn, man. I'll tell you. We're going to really enjoy watching him, man.
Yeah, he had a really good season with the Cowboys, 11 and a half sacks, batted down a couple of passes at the line of scrimmage. He did a lot and only played like half the snaps of a Daniil Hunter, who played over 1,000 snaps, and yet he delivered similar numbers and with half the snaps. Yeah. If the Bears coaching staff deploys him wisely and doesn't overuse him and so forth, I think he could have a good season.
Right. But like, you know, you guys said, there's holes at safety, cornerback, offensive line, a wide receiver. I mean, I'd love to have somebody opposite Allen Robinson. You know, I'm not sure.
Robinson?
Re-sign Robinson?
Do you think that's going to happen before the season starts, if we have a season?
Yeah, they have to free up some cap stuff, you know. But I think that's one way they can sign a safety in a corner is to extend the contract, and that will help manipulate for some more cap room.
Yeah, convert Allen Robinson's remaining contract into a signing bonus.
Right.
That they can spread out over the remainder of the deal. But
did you all see all the picks the Bills gave up to get Diggs from the Vikings?
Oh, my God, that's crazy.
Did they trade for Jerry Rice?
The Bills going for it, though. They're going for it.
I wonder if New England has a quarterback now.
They do not.
They don't.
I wonder if we'll play. And so Buffalo should be ideally the front runner for the division on paper.
Andy Dalton.
Absolutely.
I wonder if they'll maybe the Patriots will trade up and draft a quarterback.
Mm-hmm. They'll take Mitch from us, and he'll go win a fucking Super Bowl there.
Yeah.
They'll sign Joe Flacco and they'll tank the season and get Trevor Lawrence.
Bill Belichick loves Joe Flacco. You know,
he wants to toss his salad. Yeah,
he's got Flacco's beaten him a couple times. He's like, he just finds a way to beat us. But Flacco failed his physical, and that's why he's out of Denver. So
isn't it amazing that Elway, who I think Phil and I both agreed, and Phil's dad too, I think, said that the best passer we ever saw play in the NFL can't get a quarterback as a GM. How many busts is he drafted? Yeah. Other than Peyton Manning, Elway should know quarterbacks, right?
He should.
Yeah.
Like Elway. Like, Elway kind of gets not enough love.
Now he's got Drew Locke, and they just grabbed another guy. I forget. Who did they sign, Joe? It was a young quarterback.
Yeah, I know. I was just reading it. I can't remember his name.
Jeff Driscoll.
Oh, the guy from the Lions?
Yeah, they have Drew Locke and Jeff Driscoll.
Well, and now they signed Melvin Gordon for some reason.
Yeah, and Melvin Gordon as well.
Well, Jeff Driscoll. Elway's not that's not his guy, I don't think.
No.
Well, after the draft, Joe and I will have to do a fantasy football goon free agency draft. Fantasy football outlook show.
Yeah, I mean, it's going to be a wacky free agency. I'm looking forward to the fantasy year next. Well, hopefully the season happens, but I'm looking forward to that.
They're doing the NFL draft in a webinar, I think, right, Aldo?
Yeah, that's right. That's exactly right.
Right. That's why I was in two WebExes today working from home. Shit.
Yeah, me too, man. It's fucking weird.
Did you also?
Yeah, I think we're going to have like a 12-game NFL season is what I think.
Wow. Yeah, if it's this virus continues prolonged, man.
That's what I was going to say. Like again, it's not that I'm a huge wrestling guy, but WWE is doing the WrestleMania in front of no audience this year.
Yeah.
Could you imagine if the NFL played their games with nobody at the stadium?
It'll be like playing the Chargers. All right, fellas.
Hold on 1 second. Aldo here, babe. Okay. You want to say hi to the gang? I thought she was going to come by and say hi. She's going to work with coronavirus patients. My
yeah,
wife.
Please give her our love and
no prayers. Doubt.
She's heading out right now. She works 11 to 7:30, and I'll be at home with the girls. And, man, they beat the shit out of me, kick me in my sleep, kick me in the nuts, you know.
Well, take one of those hits for me, all right?
Aldo, thanks again for lending your star power to the show.
I was fun, man. Yeah. Thank you.
It was awesome. Thanks again. And, Dan, thanks for coming on. And
hell yeah.
And hopefully you do okay. Stay safe all out there in West Virginia.
Thank you, sir. You as well out there in Iowa.
Yes, Des Moines.
Des Moines.
Yep. I'll put the show up on the YouTube channel either late tonight or first thing in the morning.
Well, thanks.
You got it. I'm uploading it right now to Podbean, Aldo.
Thanks, okay. Joe.
Do you still have banter at the end?
What's that?
What?
The banter at the end. I think all that was gold. I hope you can put that on the podcast.
So the Bears stuff, we did talk a little Bears at the end.
I have it. It's still recording, so I could use it for something else.
I love how One in a Proof does that when they've already done the shout outs and then you still hear them talk a few minutes.
I'm okay with you leaving it in, Joe.
I think it's cool, man.
We could definitely do that.
Mm-hmm.
And last thing, Aldo, your comment about your dick scaring the children or whatever that was. I literally belly laughed from that shit, man. That was so great.
All right.
I'm not sure my wife liked that joke, but I don't think she liked it, to be honest with you. So. Take care, fellas.
All right. All right, thanks, gang. Aldo.
Later, guys.
End of story. Bye-bye. See you later.